Notre Dame from Syracuse in 1995 and was elected a member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences in 2005. He has authored or edited over a dozen books. Let me mention a couple. 2014, Existence, Essays in Ontology. 2009, Metaphysics, that's the third edition. 2007, Persons, Human and Divine. 2006, The Problem of Evil. And 2001, Ontology, Identity and Modality. He has also authored and published many articles in professional journals, as well as written book reviews. Please welcome Professor Peter van Inwagen.
Thank you so much.
And we also have handouts, I will pass them around.
It's always a pleasure to interact with Bill. This is hardly the first time. We don't agree about that very much, but we always have a good time. So I thought that what I would do in these remarks was to say something about chapters 6 and 7 of that overall. That's the chapters on ontological commitment. But on reading those chapters, I found that I understood very little of what was said. Well, no great surprise there. I'm notorious for not understanding, or as some would have it, pretending not to understand what other philosophers say. I should also remark that someone who read those chapters and did not know my work would come away from them with a radically wrong conception of my views on ontological commitment. And most of this wrongness would be due to the cumulative effect of misapprehensions of this or that aspect of these views in many passages. I'll make just two general points. First, I'm treated as one who is an adherent of a position that Bill calls Neo-Quantianism. And indeed, that is my own name for my meta-ontological position. But Bill ascribes two theses to Neo-Quantianism that militate against my being a Neo-Quantian in his sense. And one is that a central pillar of Neo-Quantianism is the so-called Quine-Putnam indispensability argument. And that's not only an argument I have not used in my work, it's an argument I have denounced. Secondly, Bill states that Neo-Quantians differ from Paleo-Quantians, such as Quine, in the following respect. Paleo-Quantians hold that ontological commitment is carried only by the existential quantifier, and Neo-Quantians hold that it is also carried by singular terms. And the thesis that singular terms carry ontological commitment is one that I'd be willing to endorse only in so elaborately qualified a form that there wouldn't be much left of it. Well, because of all this, I can't directly address the arguments of those two chapters, not in these remarks. If I were to address them directly, I'd have to write a sentence-by-sentence commentary on them that was many times longer than the chapters themselves. What I'm going to do is to go back to fundamentals to present a sort of précis of my position on ontological commitment, whether you call it Neo-Quantianism or not, and its implications for the nominalism-realism debate, a précis that proceeds from first principles, so here goes. Sometimes a philosopher says things that seem prima facie to contradict one another, and which, nevertheless, do not indisputably contradict one another. Suppose, for example, that I tell you that a certain philosopher, Janus, has written an essay called The Divine Attributes, an essay that contains both the following sentences. And the sentences were used, not mentioned, and were used as straightforward vehicles of authorial assertion. These are sentences 1 and 2 in the handout. God is omnipotent, and God is unable to break a promise he has made. Having told you this, I go on to inform you that my colleague Jake, on reading The Divine Attributes, has charged Janus with contradicting himself, owing to the fact that sentences 1 and 2 are, so Jake contends, logical contraries. Is Jake right? Well, if you know nothing relevant to this question but what I have told you, you have no way to answer it. For whatever one might want to say about sentence 2, philosophers and theologians who have used sentence one have used it with more than one meaning. That is, they've used it to affirm more than one proposition. Let's suppose, for the sake of argument, as one says, that sentence two is wholly unambiguous. There's only one proposition it could express. It's at least a defensible position that when Descartes spoke or wrote sentence one, or at any rate the sentence Deus omnipotens est, he used it to express a proposition that was inconsistent with the proposition expressed by sentence two, and that when Aquinas wrote or spoke sentence one, he used it to express a proposition that was consistent with the proposition expressed by sentence two. And since what I've told you does not say enough for you to be able to determine what proposition Janus used sentence one to express, you are not in a position to say whether Jake was right. Similar considerations apply, and with a vengeance, to the writings of nominalists. Now, Janus's CV, I hereby inform you, lists among your areas of specialization not only philosophical theology, but metaphysics. And her fellow metaphysicians know her as a staunch defender of nominalism. Nominalism being the word that she herself uses to describe her position on the existence of abstracta. Now you, as I'm sure you'll be the first to admit, know nothing about Janus's defense of nominalism, and I therefore need to tell you something about it, but don't worry, not very much. Janus's unofficial statement of the nominalism she espouses is a straightforward transposition of the singular number of the famous creedal confession of Goodman and Quine. I do not believe in abstract entities. No one supposes that abstract entities, classes, relations, properties, etc., exist in space-time, but I mean more than that, I renounce them altogether. And if this statement, this appealingly forthright statement, to quote Quine's description of his and Goodman's original statement, was insufficiently clear, Janus has, in her seminal essay, New Steps Toward a Constructive Nominalism, appended to it the following gloss. Look at sentences 3 and 4 in the handout. There are no abstract objects, entities, things, items. And that justly celebrated essay also contains the following sentence, number 4. Although there are sentences that may appear to express truths that appear also to imply that there are abstract objects, appearance is not reality. Each of these sentences either does not express a truth or else does not imply that there are abstract objects. Now, having given you only this meager knowledge of information concerning the content of New Steps Toward a Constructive Nominalism, I go on to tell you that Jake, who's a persistent and indefatigable critic of every aspect of Janus's work, the moment he had finished reading New Steps, proceeded a second time to charge Janus with contradicting herself. For he contended, sentences 3 and 4 are logical contraries, owing to the fact that by sentence, Janus can only have meant sentence type, and he further contended, sentence types, if they exist, must be abstract objects. Well, did Janus contradict herself? Obviously, you can answer this question only if you know what propositions Janus used sentences 3 and 4 to express. You might be able to answer it if you didn't know what she meant by abstract object, but did know that she meant the same thing by it in both sentences, but that qualification won't affect the point I'm attempting to make. So I'll ignore it. Let's suppose, again for the sake of argument, that it's clear enough to you what proposition she used in sentence 3 to express. Let's suppose there's no doubt in your mind, rightly no doubt in your mind, that Janus used sentence 3 to express the proposition also expressed by the sentence on the handout 3 prime. It is not true of anything that it is an abstract object. Or a notational variant in sentence 3 prime, sentence 3 second, there is no X such that X is an abstract object. But what proposition did she use sentence 4 to express? If we simply examine sentence 4, examine it without attending to the role it plays in the larger text in which it is embedded, to wit, the essay New Steps Toward Constructive Nominalism, we might well conclude that it expressed the same proposition as the proposition expressed by sentence 4 prime in the handout, there is an X such that X is a sentence type, and X appears to express the truth, and X appears to apply to clear abstract objects, and in anything that expresses the truth, appears to express the truth, appears to apply to clear abstract objects, such that either it doesn't express the truth or it doesn't apply to clear abstract objects. And this conclusion would, of course, indicate Jake's charge that in writing both sentence 3 and sentence 4 for Virginia, the genus had contradicted itself, for just by applying a little logic to that, the sentence 3 and sentence 4, and say the analytic sentence 6 in the handout, you can get there is an abstract object, and it's the case that there isn't. There aren't any abstract objects. But did Janus use sentence 4 to express the proposition expressed by sentence 4 prime? I'd certainly not expect Janus to tell us that she used sentence 4 to express that proposition. Well, then she would be telling us that she had affirmed two theses that were self-evidently logical contraries. And why, I would ask, would a highly intelligent and extremely able philosopher like Janus affirm two propositions whose conjunction she herself regarded as obviously implying a contradiction? Nevertheless, Jake's charge that Janus has contradicted herself has raised a question that demands an answer. If the proposition Janus used sentence 4 to express is not the proposition expressed by sentence 4 prime, what is the proposition that she's used sentence 4 to express? For all you know, of course, she has answered that question. You don't know how Janus would answer or has answered this question, but you have an obvious way to find out. You can ask her. Suppose you did. What do you think she would say? Well, I'm afraid I can't help you with that question, for she hasn't told me. And I can't think of anything that sentence 4 could reasonably be supposed to express that was not at least so close to what sentence 4 prime expresses that the difference between them would be of no philosophical consequence. Well, this little story is an illustration of Quine's criterion of ontological commitment at work, at least in my own understanding of that criterion. I've said that one of the core components of Quine's meta-ontology, and here's the handout, you see a rather long quotation from one of my papers. Quine's meta-ontology is a proposal about the way in which philosophical disputes about what there is should be conducted. We might call them his rules for conducting an ontological dispute. And here are the rules. The parties to such a dispute should examine, or be willing in principle to examine, the ontological implications of everything they want to affirm. Parenthesis. Quine assigns a special central role to the affirmations of physical science in his discussions of ontological commitment. I would say that this was a consequence of certain of his epistemological commitments and not of his ontology. End of parenthesis. Now, this examination should consist in various attempts to render the things they want to affirm into the quantifier of variability in sufficient depth that all the inferences they want to make from the things they want to affirm are logically valid. The ontological implications of the things they affirm will be precisely the class of closed sentences starting with an existential quantifier phrase, whose scope is the remainder of the sentence, of the renderings into the quantifier variability of those things they want to affirm. Parties to the dispute who are unwilling to accept some of the ontological implications of rendering some theses they have affirmed into the quantifier variability must find some other way of rendering that thesis into the quantifier variability. That is, must find a paraphrase that they are willing to accept and which does not have the unwanted implication. If these rules, that's the end of the statement of the rules, if these rules are not followed, then, so say those of us who are adherents of Quine's meta-ontology, it is almost certain that many untoward consequences of the disputed positions will be obscured by imprecision and wishful thinking. I'll remark that the phrase, the quantifier variability, is my preferred term for what Quine calls the canonical The rules described in this passage are precisely the rules I was attempting to follow when I raised the question, what proposition does Genesis sentence 4 express if it is not the proposition expressed by sentence 4 prime? For sentence 4 prime is simply an obvious and straightforward translation of sentence 4 to expound into the quantifier variable again. If Janice indeed tells us that she did not use sentence 4 to express the proposition expressed by sentence 4 prime, we could address the same question to Janice herself. All right, Janice, the proposition you mean sentence 4 to express is not the proposition expressed by an obvious and straightforward translation of that sentence into the quantifier variability. Fine. There's no rule that says the sentences of natural language that occur in a philosophical text must express the proposition expressed by any sentence that is an obvious and blah, blah, blah. But then, what is the proposition you meant to affirm when you wrote sentence 4? Now, let's suppose that Janice does answer this question. She answers it, of course, by speaking some words, by uttering a certain sentence. Now, this is a handout. For some sentence P, a sentence that expresses a proposition that is, or at least so she maintains, consistent with Platonism, she utters a longer sentence in which P is embedded. That is, she utters a sentence that consists of the words, written on the handout here, I use the sentence, and then the quotation name, sentence appears, to express the proposition that, and then P. That is to say, she answers the question put to her by presenting the questioner with a sentence she believes to be a nominalistically acceptable paraphrase of her sentence 4, to wit, the sentence P, whatever it might be. As I said, I have no idea what the paraphrase might be. If she does this, she's following Quine's rules for conducting an ontological dispute. Now, there are philosophers who refuse to follow those rules. There are philosophers who are unwilling to model their conduct in ontological disputes on the debate between the admirable Argle and Bargle concerning the existence of holes. That's holes with an H, not holes with a W. Some philosophers, I regret to say, are the school of the late Ernest Gellner, who, having professed to call himself a nominalist, went on to say, the dreadful thing is, I haven't even tried to be a serious card-carrying nominalist. I've never tried to eliminate quantification, because the word quantification, quotation mark, quantification over abstract objects from my discourse. I shamelessly, quote, quantify over, unquote, abstractions and deny their existence. I do not try to put what I say into canonical notation and do not care what the notation looks like if someone else does it before me, and do not feel in the least bound by whatever object commitments such a translation may disclose. In my view, Kellner's confession comes down to this. I don't mind contradicting myself. I don't mind saying things that imply that there are abstractions and saying things that are implied there are no abstractions, if figuring out how to avoid contradicting myself would require intellectual effort. I would never discuss the existence of abstract objects with a philosopher who was willing to say what Gellner has said in that passage. In my view, it would be a waste of my time. I don't mean I would refuse to talk to a philosopher of Gellner's stripe about any question relevant to the existence of abstract objects, but I'd insist that our topic be the proper conduct of ontological disputes, particularly of ontological disputes about abstract objects, as opposed to a discussion of the existence of abstract objects. And you come right down to it, the reason I follow Quine's rules is that I don't fancy contradicting myself. And if someone points out that I have apparently contradicted myself, I don't regard, oh, so I have, but so what, as a satisfactory response. Suppose that I have said, as indeed I have, this is on the handout, that there are, in the strict and philosophical sense, of course, no composite inanimate objects. And suppose also that at the meeting of my chapter of the Save the Earth Society, I've said, look, internal combustion engines exist, and they play an important role in the economy. has some explaining to do because an obvious and straightforward translation of my statement to the safety of society into the quantifier variability logically implies the proposition that there are internal combustion engines, and such internal combustion engines as there may be must be composite, abstract, or composite inanimate objects. And unless I'm prepared either to embrace a contradiction or to concede that at least one of my two statements was false, there is only one form this explanation can take. I must say that although my two statements appear to contradict each other, that appearance is not reality, and I must explain how it is that these two apparently contradictory statements can both be true. If organicism is the thesis that all composite objects are biological organisms, the core of any such explanation would presumably be, so to call it, an organicistically acceptable paraphrase of my statement to the Save the Earth Society. But my present point does not concern the question of what form that explanation would take. It is simply that Quine's rules that reveal the need for such an explanation, whatever form it might take. Now this example, simply in virtue of its office as an illustrative example, concerns a very straightforward and obvious apparent contradiction. In all cases of apparent contradiction between some of the metaphysician's assertions and his or her general positions in ontology were as obvious as this, there would have been no need for Quine ever to have stated his rules. Our earlier example, however, the example of Janus, who having denied the existence of abstract objects, apparently affirmed the existence of certain abstract objects, sentence types is more interesting. There, the apparent contradiction is not quite so obvious. Fairly obvious, to be sure, but not quite so obvious. At a meeting of this division of the APA 60 years ago, in a symposium on ontological commitment, Alonso presented a paper appropriately called Ontological Commitment. In this paper, now regarded as one of the classic papers on the subject, he presented a very telling collection of examples and passages taken from the work of three nominalistically inclined philosophers. Passages such that it was very hard to see why the sentences in each of these passages did not logically imply the existence of abstract objects. Church's three victims, so to call them, were philosophers of the very highest reputation, A.J. Ayer, Arthur Papp, and Gilbert Ryle. Here, for example, are two passages, two sentences from a long passage that Church quotes from Ayer's Thinking and Meaning. Ayer said, "It makes sense to say, in a case where someone is believing or doubting or whatever it may be, that there is something that he doubts or believes. But it does not follow from this that something must exist to be doubted or believed in the way that something must exist to be eaten or struck." And here is Church's trenchant comment. This is the passage which shows most clearly that Ayer wishes simultaneously to say that there is something that someone believes and deny that there exists something to be believed. I'll add my own comment, perhaps less trenchant than Church's, but very much in the same spirit as his. I should like to have been in a position to ask Ayer whether his words implied the following statement. This is a handout. "There is an X such that X is believed by the Pope. Does not follow from there is an X such that the Pope believes X." And if I had asked that question, Ayer replied that his words did not imply that statement, I should have asked him how it could be that they did, for they certainly seemed to have that implication. In my view, if Quine had never put forward his rules for the conduct of ontological disputes, the apparent contradiction in Ayer's words, glaring though it is in hindsight, would have gone unnoticed. One might indeed wonder how trained philosophers could fail to notice an apparent contradiction that was so very, well, glaring. I don't know what to say about that mysterious failure, But, you know, life is full of mysteries. And as Church's other examples go some way toward showing, this passage is far more unique. The writings of professed nominalists are shot through with passages that apparently affirm the existence of abstract objects of one sort or another. My position on ontological commitment and nominalism is this. Attention to Quine's rules shows that it's very hard for nominalists to avoid apparently contradicting themselves. It is, moreover, very hard to see how the apparent contradictions that afflict the discourse of nominalists might be only apparent. In fact, no one has ever done this. This is my reason for rejecting nominalism. Which I really, really want to accept. I hate having to affirm the existence of abstraction. But I don't want to refrain from saying the things I say every day that apparently imply the existence of abstraction. If that were my practice, I could say very little indeed. And I don't see any hope of showing that these apparent contradictions are only apparent. They certainly look real enough to me. And as I've said, I don't fancy contradicting myself. Although I really, really want to be a nominalist, I don't want to be one badly enough to purchase a button that reads, "I'm a nominalist and I'm proud," at the price of contradicting myself. After all, contradictions are false. And as Tarski once said, "Inimicus Plato, sed magis inimica falsitas." We've lost that at the bottom. There are two paragraphs.
Thank you very much, Professor Van Inwagen. According to the wish of our speakers, we could take a short break, 2 minutes, so that you can grab